So here in this video, we'll discuss about second metacarpal bone. Now this is right articulated hand I have, and if you hold it in anatomical position, so this is the second metacarpal bone. This is an example of miniature long bone, and it is the longest metacarpal out of all five. So when you see separate metacarpals, with the length only you can identify a given metacarpal as a second metacarpal. So this is the second metacarpal. Now, as I told you, it is an example of miniature long bone. So it is having a base, a shaft and a head. Now proximally, the base will articulate with three carpal bones, mainly with the trapezoid and partly with trapezium and capitate. So this is how it gets articulated. Similarly, distally it will articulate with the proximal phalanx of index finger, and that forms metacarpophalangeal joint. Over here, carpometacarpal joint is formed. So this is the plane synovial, whereas the metacarpophalangeal joint is ellipsoid synovial. Now let's see bony features. So first is the base. Now it is having a grooved articular facet, and with this grooved articular facet also you can identify a given metacarpal as second metacarpal. It is having a prominent medial lip. See this. Now this grooved articular facet will connect with corresponding articular facet found along the distal aspect of the trapezoid. So this is right trapezoid I have, and along its distal aspect you can see there is an articular facet which is having a ridge in the center and two slopes on either side. So this entire thing will fix with the groove along the base like this, and these two together will form carpometacarpal joint. So similar thing you can appreciate in articulated hand. See, this is the trapezoid, and over here there is a groove. So these two are connected to form carpometacarpal joint. Now we know trapezoid is smaller as compared to trapezium and capitate. So the distal articular facet will not reach to the same level of distal articular facets of trapezium and capitate. Okay, it will remain little bit proximally, and that forms a notch over here, and within the notch the second metacarpal, which is longest, will get mortised, and that will become almost immobile. So mobility is minimum for the second metacarpal because of this region. Now the main connection of second metacarpal, base of second metacarpal, is with trapezoid, but partly it is also connected to trapezium and capitate. So for that, it is also having corresponding articular facets. So this is a groove for trapezoid. Now dorsolaterally you will find a quadrilateral articular facet, and that will connect with corresponding articular facet of trapezium. So this is right trapezium I have, and along its medial aspect there is a quadrilateral articular facet, and these two together will connect like this. So dorsolaterally second metacarpal will connect with trapezium. Similar thing you can appreciate over here. There is an articular facet, and this is the trapezium. So these two are connected like this. So if we join these three together, trapezium, trapezoid and second metacarpal, so this is how they are connected. See this. Okay, now medially there is capitate, so there is a facet for capitate also. Now as I told you, the medial lip of the groove is prominent, and along the medial groove there is a facet for capitate. So here is a right capitate, and if you see its distal surface, there are two semi facets. Lateral one is for the second metacarpal, and this medial one, which is larger, it is for the third metacarpal. So over here the second metacarpal will connect. It's basically its medial lip of the groove will connect. So this is how these two are connected. So if I connect trapezoid also over here, these three are connected like this. See this. So principal connection is with the trapezoid, and medially there is a separate facet in the form of the medial lip of the groove for the capitate, like this. Okay, now more medially there is base of third metacarpal, so these two are connected with each other, and for that also it is having a separate articular facet. So medially, above this medial lip of groove, there is an indented articular facet. See this. Now this is for the base of third metacarpal. So lateral aspect of the third metacarpal will be having corresponding articular facet. See over here, you can clearly see. Now these two will connect like this to form intermetacarpal joint. Say this. So the same thing you can appreciate in articulated hand. See over here. So here will be that articular facet. So this is how all around the base of second metacarpal is connected. Now along the palmar surface of the base, there is insertion of flexor carpi radialis tendon, which is basically coming from the groove found along the trapezium, and then it will insert along the palmar surface of the base of second metacarpal. Similarly, along the dorsal surface, the base will receive insertion of extensor carpi radialis longus. Now next is a shaft. It is having a palmar surface and a dorsal surface. Now this dorsal surface is having a flat triangular area with apex facing towards the base. See this. Whereas the palmar surface is concave. You can appreciate from the side. See the concavity. Now this is subdivided by a vertical ridge into anterolateral area and anteromedial area. So this anterolateral area, see over here in articulated hand, the anterolateral area will provide origin to first dorsal introsus. So here lies the first dorsal introsus, which is a bipinnate muscle, and that takes origin from either sides of shafts of first and second metacarpal over here. Similarly, this space between the shafts of second and third metacarpal will be occupying second dorsal introsus. Again, it is a bipinnate muscle, so that will take origin from either sides of shafts of second and third metacarpal. So this anteromedial area will provide origin to second dorsal introsus, whereas this anterolateral area will provide origin to first dorsal introsus muscle. Similarly, a thin strip along the anteromedial area of the shaft over here will provide origin to second palmar introsus, which is a unipennate muscle. So on either side there are attachment of introsi. Next is a head, which is having a convex articular facet, and that will connect with corresponding articular facet of the proximal phalanx of index finger, and that will form metacarpophalangeal joint, which is ellipsoid variety of synovial joint. Now some points regarding side determination. So this is head, this is base, and this is the concave palmar surface. So these things are very easy to identify. Now how to determine the side? So when you see the base, as we have discussed, the medial lip of the grooved articular facet is prominent. So this should be medially, and dorsolaterally you will find a quadrilateral articular facet. So this is lateral, this is medial, this is along the palmar surface concavity. This will be the dorsal aspect. So this is right second metacarpal I have. Okay. Similarly, when you see the left one, this is the concave palmar surface. This is dorsal aspect. And along the base, see, this is a grooved articular facet with prominent medial lip. And along the dorsolateral aspect, you will find a quadrilateral articular facet. So this is left second metacarpal bone. So these points will help you to determine side of given second metacarpal. So this is regarding general features, attachments, and points regarding side determination of second metacarpal bone. Hope you have understood well. Thanks for watching.